Hello, everybody. I am very excited because this week we're going to start what I'm calling Fairy Tale Week. So, this week I'm going to read you a new fairy tale every day, and most excitingly, you're going to get to write your own fairy tale. So I'm going to read one every day so you can get some ideas and things that you may want to include in your fairy tale, or some things that you may decide you really don't want to include in your fairy tale. So we're going to do it one step at a time. Today, we're going to focus on the setting of your fairy tale. So remember, the setting is where the story takes place. So as I read today's fairy tale, you can think about what type of setting you might want for your own fairy tale. So I have this big book of fairy tales right here, and we're going to read my favorite fairy tale today. Starting with my favorite because I just couldn't wait. It is called The Fisherman and His Wife. Now this book does have some pictures, so if there's a picture, just like with A to Z Mysteries, I'll show you. But some pages don't have a picture. Now we've talked a little bit about fairy tales before and the characteristics that make something a fairy tale. Usually there is a phrase at the beginning and a phrase at the end. Do you remember what those were? Probably do. Typically, fairy tales start with the phrase, once upon a time, or there was once upon a time, and they usually end with the phrase, happily ever after. We should see if these fairy tales have those. Remember, fairy tales also fall under the fiction umbrella, so they're not real. They're pretend, but they sure are fun. Let's get started with The Fisherman and His Wife. There was once a fisherman who lived with his wife in a miserable little hut close to the sea. He went to fish every day, and he fished and fished, and at last one day, as he was sitting looking deep into the shining water, he felt something on his line. When he hauled it up, there was a great flounder at the end of the line. The flounder said to him, "Listen, fisherman, I beg you not to kill me. I'm no common flounder. I am an enchanted prince. What good will it do you to kill me? I shan't be good to eat. Put me back in the water and leave me to swim about." "Ho, ho," said the fisherman, "you need not make so many words about it. I'm quite ready to put back a flounder that can talk." And so saying, he put the flounder into the shining water, and it sank down to the bottom. Then the fisherman got up and went back to his wife in the little hut. "Husband," she said, "have you caught anything today?" "No," said the man, "all I caught was one flounder, and he said he was an enchanted prince, so I let him swim again." "Did you not wish for anything then?" asked the wife. "No," said the man, "what was there to wish for?" "Alas," said the wife, "isn't it bad enough always to live in this wretched little hut? You might have at least wished for a nice clean cottage. Go back and call him. Tell him I want a pretty cottage. Surely he will give us that." "Alas," said the man, "what am I to go back there for?" "Well," said the woman, "it was you who caught him and let him go. So certainly he'll do this for you. Be off now." The man was still not very willing to go, but he did not want to vex his wife. So at last he went back to the sea. He found the sea no longer bright and shining, but dull and green. He stood by it and said, "Flounder, flounder by the sea, please listen to me. My wife Isabel must have her will and begs me to ask a favor of you." The flounder came swimming up and said, "Well, what do you want?" "Alas," said the man, "I had to call you, for my wife and I said I ought to have wished for something as I caught you. She didn't want to live in our miserable little hut any longer. She wants a pretty cottage." "Go home then," said the flounder. "She has her wish fully." The man went home and found his wife no longer in the old hut, but in a pretty little cottage. His wife was sitting on a bench by the door. She took him by the hand and said, "Come and look in here. Isn't this much better?" They went inside and found a pretty sitting room and a bedroom with a comfy bed in it, a kitchen and a larder furnished with everything from the best tin and brass and every possible requisite. Outside there was a little yard with chickens and ducks and a little garden full of vegetables and fruit. "Look," said the woman, "is this not nice?" "Yes," said the man, "and so let it remain. We can live here very happily." "We will see about that," said the woman. With that, they ate something and went to bed. Everything went well for a week or so, and then the wife said, "Listen, husband, this cottage is too cramped, and the garden is too small. The flounder could have given us a bigger house. I want to live in a big stone castle. Go to the flounder and tell him to give us a castle." "Alas," said the wife, "the cottage is good enough for us. What will we want with a castle?" "Never mind that," said the wife, "but go to the flounder and he will manage it." "No, wife," said the man, "the flounder gave us the cottage. I don't want to go back, as he will likely be angry." "Go, all the same," said the woman. "He can do it easily enough and willingly into the bargain. Just go." The man's heart was heavy, and he was unwilling to go. He said to himself, "It is not right." but at last he went. He found the sea was no longer green. It was still calm, but dark violet and gray. He stood by it and said, "Flounder, flounder in the sea, please listen to me. My wife Isabel must have her will, and sends me to ask a favor of you." "Now what do you want?" said the flounder. "Alas," said the man, half scared, "my wife wants a big stone castle." "Go home again," said the flounder. "She is standing at the door of it." Then the man went away, thinking that he would find no house. But when he got back, he found a great stone palace, and his wife standing at the top of the steps, waiting to go in. She took him by the hand and said, "Come in with me." With that, they went in and found a great hall paved with marble slabs, the number of servants and attendants who opened the great doors of them. The walls were hung with beautiful tapestries, and the rooms were furnished with golden chairs and tables. While rich carpets covered the floors, the crystal chandeliers hung from the ceilings. The tables groaned under every kind of delicate food and the most costly wines. Outside the house, there was a great courtyard with a stabling for horses and cows and many fine carriages. Beyond this, there was a great garden filled with the loveliest flowers and fine fruit trees. There was also a park half a mile long, and in it were stags and hinds and hares and everything of the kind one could wish for. "Now," said the woman, "is this not worth having?" "Oh, yes," said the man, "and so let it remain. We will live in this beautiful palace and be content." "We will think about that," said the wife, "and sleep upon it." With that, they went to bed. The next morning, the wife woke up first. Day was just dawning, and from her bed she could see the beautiful country around her. Her husband was still asleep, but she pushed him with her elbow and said, "Husband, get up and look out the window. See here now, could we not be king over all this land? Go to the flounder. We will be king." "Alas," said the man, "what could we want to be king for? I don't want to be king." "Ah," said the wife, "if you will not be king, I will. Go to the flounder. I will be king." "Alas," said the man, "whatever you want to, do you want to be king for? I don't like to ask him." "Why not?" said the woman. "Go, you must. I will be king." So the man went, but he was quite sad because his wife would be king. "It's not right," he said. "It is not right." When he reached the sea, he found it dark gray and rough and evil smelling. I wonder if you notice what's happening to the sea every time he goes back to it. First it was shining and bright. And now slowly and slowly it's turned darker. Now it's gray and rough and evil smelling. Oh no. "Flounder, flounder in the sea, please listen to me. My wife Isabel must have her will and sends me to ask a favor of you." "Now what does she want?" said the flounder. "Alas," said the man, "she wants to be king now." "Go back, she is king already," said the flounder. So the man went back, and when he reached the palace, he found that it had grown much larger, and a great tower had been added with handsome decorations. There was a sentry at the door, and a number of soldiers were playing drums and trumpets. As soon as he got inside the palace, he found everything was marble and gold, and the hangings were of velvet with great golden tassels. The doors of the saloon were thrown wide open, and he saw that the whole court was assembled. His wife was sitting on a lofty throne of gold and diamonds. She wore a golden crown and carried it in one hand, a scepter of pure gold. On each side of her stood ladies in a long row, every one a head shorter than the next. He stood before her and said, "Alas, wife, are you king now?" "Yes," she said, "now I am king." He stood before her and said, "Alas, wife, are you king now?" "Yes," she said, "now I am king." He stood looking at her for some time, and then he said, "Ah, wife, it is a fine thing for you to be king. Now we will not wish to be anything more." "No, husband," she answered quite uneasily. "I find the time hang very heavy on my hands. I can't bear it any longer. Go back to the flounder. King I am, but I must also be emperor." "Alas, wife," said the man, "why do you want to be emperor?" "Husband," she answered, "go to the flounder. Emperor I will be." "Alas, wife," said the man, "emperor he can't make you, and I won't ask him. There is only one emperor in the country. The emperor, the flounder, cannot make you. That he can't." "What?" said the woman. "I am king, and you are but my husband. To him you must go, and right quickly. If he can make a king, he can also make an emperor. Emperor I will be, so go quickly." He had to go, but he was quite frightened. As he went, he thought, "This won't end well. Emperor is too shameless. The flounder will make an end of the whole thing." With that, he came to the sea. But now he found it quite black and heaving up from below in great waves. It tossed to and fro, and a sharp wind blew over it. The man trembled as he stood there. He said, "Flounder, flounder in the sea, please listen to me. My wife Isabel must have her will and sends me to ask a favor of you." "What does she want now?" said the flounder. "Alas, flounder," he said, "my wife wants to be emperor." "Go back," said the flounder, "she is emperor." So the man went back, and when he got to the door, he found that the whole palace was made of polished marble, with alabaster figures and golden decorations. Soldiers marched up and down before the doors, blowing their trumpets and beating their drums. Inside the palace, counts, barons, and dukes walked about as attendants, and they opened the doors to him, which were made of pure gold. He went in and saw his wife sitting on a huge throne made of solid gold. It was at least 2 miles high. She had on her head a great golden crown set with diamonds 3 yards high. In one hand she held the scepter, and in the other the orb of the empire. On each side of her stood the gentlemen in arms in two rows, each one a little smaller than the other. From giants 2 miles high down to the tiniest dwarf no bigger than a little finger, she was surrounded by princes and dukes. Her husband stood still and said, "Wife, are you emperor?" "Yes," she said. "Now I am emperor." So I wonder what you think so far. Do you think that the wife is going to be happy to be emperor now? Or do you think she's going to want something new? Let's find out. "Husband," she said, "what are you standing there for? Now I am emperor. I want to be pope." "Go back to the flounder." "Alas, wife," said the man, "what would you want that for? Pope you can't be. There's only one pope in Christendom. That's more than the flounder can do." "Husband," she said, "pope I will be, so go at once. I must be pope this very day." "No, wife," he said, "I dare not tell him. It's no good. It's too monstrous altogether. The flounder cannot make thee pope." "Husband," said the woman, "don't talk nonsense. If he can make an emperor, he can make a pope. Go immediately. I am emperor, and you are but my husband. You must obey." So he was frightened, and he went, but he was quite dazed. He shivered and shook, and his knees trembled. A great wind arose over the land. The clouds flew across the sky, and it grew as dark as night. The leaves fell from the trees, and the water foamed and dashed upon the shore. In the distance, the ships were being tossed to and fro on the waves, and he heard them firing signals of distress. There was a little patch of blue sky among the dark clouds, but towards the south they were red and heavy as in a bad storm. In despair, he stood and said, "Flounder, flounder in the sea, please listen to me. My wife Isabel must have her will and begs me to ask a favor of you." "Now what does she want?" said the flounder. "Alas," said the man, "she wants to be pope." "Go back. Pope she is," said the flounder. So back he went and found a great church surrounded with palaces. He pressed through the crowd, and inside he found thousands and thousands of lights. And his wife, entirely clad in gold, was sitting on still a higher throne with 3 golden crowns upon her head and was surrounded with priestly state. On each side of her were 2 rows of candles, the biggest as thick as a tower down to the tiniest little taper. Kings and emperors were on their knees before her, kissing her shoe. "Wife," said the man, looking at her, "are you pope?" "Yes," she said, "now I am pope." So there he stood gazing at her, and it was like looking at a shining sun. "Alas, wife," he said, "are you better off for being pope?" At first she sat as stiff as a post, without stirring. Then he said, "Now, wife, be content with being pope. Higher you can't go." "I will think about that," said the woman, and with that they both went to bed. Still she was not content, and could not sleep for her inordinate desires. The man slept well and soundly, for he had walked about a great deal in the day, but his wife could think of nothing but what further grandeur she could demand. When the dawn reddened the sky, she raised herself up in bed and looked out the window. When she saw the sunrise, she said, "Ha! Can I not cause the sun and moon to rise, husband?" she cried, digging her elbow into his side. "Wake up and go to the flounder. I will be lord of the universe." Her husband, who was still more than half asleep, was so shocked that he fell out of bed. He thought he must have heard wrong. He rubbed his eyes and said, "Alas, wife, what did you say?" "Husband," she said, "if I cannot be lord of the universe and cause the sun and moon to set and rise, I shall not be able to bear it. I shall never have another happy moment." She looked at him so wildly that it caused a shudder to run through him. "Alas, wife," he said, falling on his knees before her, "the flounder can't do that. Emperor and pope he can make, but that is indeed beyond him. I pray, control yourself and remain pope." Then she flew into a terrible rage. Her hair stood on end. She kicked him and screamed, "I won't bear it any longer. You will go." Then he pulled on his coat and tore away like a madman. Such a storm was raging that he could hardly keep his feet. Houses and trees quivered and swayed. The mountains trembled and the rocks rolled into the sea. The sky was pitch black. It thundered and lightning, and the sea ran as black as mountains high, crested with white foam. He shrieked out, but could hardly make himself be heard. Oh, no. Now it's not just the sea that's angry. The mountains are shaking, and it's thundering and lightning. "Flounder, flounder in the sea, please listen to me. My wife Isabel must have her will and sends me to ask a favor of you." "Now what does she want?" asked the flounder. "Alas," he said, "she wants to be lord of the universe." "Now she must go back to her old hut, and there she is." So there they are to this very day. And that's the end of that fairy tale. I love that one. I like that the sky and the sea keep getting darker and darker. I think it's interesting that the wife is never satisfied with what she has. So now the flounder says, guess what? Now you get to sit in your old hut like you started out with. So it's like they were at the very beginning. That's such a good story. I also picked that one for today because it really describes the setting very clearly. It describes the ocean and the sea. I think it does a really great job of describing what each of the palaces look like and the things that are now in the palace and what the wife looks like. So think about all those things as today you decide what setting you would like to write a story in. So it could be like this in a house by the sea. It could be in a big castle, maybe in enchanted woods, or maybe underwater. Maybe in space, in fairy tales, you don't have to have rules because it's all fiction. So today in a page in your writing journal, write a description of what the setting of your story is going to be. So write where it is and write some of the things that maybe your characters will see. Big tall trees or underwater coral. Describe the setting of your fairy tale today. Tomorrow we'll read another fairy tale and we'll add a little more. I'm very excited. See you then. Bye.